We are so excited to have each of you join us today for the first eSTEM webinar of this academic year. As you are likely aware, this webinar is part of a larger National Science Foundation funded HBCU Up Broadening Participation Research Project under award number 1912205. The project seeks to encourage interest, identity, belonging, and persistence in STEM among those historically underrepresented in STEM degrees and career fields through intentional training of undergraduate and graduate students to become peer mentors and mentees. We are thrilled today to feature Dr. Brandy Huderson. Dr. Brandy Huderson has extensive experience in higher education instruction, scientific research, informal STEM education programming, project management, qualitative and quantitative portfolio analysis, program evaluation, and federal grant management. Dr. Huderson is an assistant professor at the University of the District of Columbia, where her research focuses on steroid receptor biology in normal and abhorrent systems, as well as STEM education. Currently, Dr. Huderson serves as an American Association for the Advancement of Science and Science and Technology Policy Fellow at the National Science Foundation and the Directorate for Education and Human Resources. As a fellow, Dr. Huderson uses her expertise in STEM education and research to support the Division of Research on Learning in Formal and Informal Settings, Advancing Informal STEM Learning Program. Specifically, she uses her experience and knowledge gained from academia to conduct qualitative and quantitative portfolio analysis and program evaluation. Dr. Huderson has a BS in biology from Xavier University of Louisiana, Master's of Biological Sciences degree with concentrations in molecular genetics from the University of New Orleans, and a PhD in dairy science from Virginia Tech. Without further delay, I'm going to turn the time over to Dr. Huderson. Dr. Huderson, welcome.
Okay, you can hear me now. Okay, great. Let me first say thank you very much for the invitation. I'm really excited to be here with you all today. I am going to talk to you all today about persistence in STEM. And true to form for me, I'm going to do it the way that makes sense to me. So, can you all see my screen?
Yes, you can.
Okay, so you see the slide, not the PowerPoint project.
That is correct.
Okay, cool. So, Dr. Wendt invited me here to talk to you all today and to kind of talk about persistence in STEM. And this is something that I spent a lot of time thinking about. And so, I'm going to walk you through what I think persistence in STEM looks like. So the title of my talk is Women and Women of Color in STEM, but what do you really see? So I want to start off in true professor form with a slight quiz. You won't be graded, so don't panic. But I have a question for you. Who are these women? Who is Rebecca Cole, Lisette Montgomery, Cheryl Shavers, Scarlin Hernandez? Are these names that you've heard before? Do they sound familiar to you? If not, don't panic. I am going to provide you with a little bit of information about them. So Rebecca Cole was the second African-American woman to receive an MD degree in the United States. She received her degree from the Pennsylvania Women's College of Medicine. And at the time she received her degree, there was the first ever woman dean of that college. Lisette Montgomery is a video game artist and designer. She has contributed to games such as Sims 4, Tiger Woods Golf, The Simpsons. These are games that you may or may not have heard of, but these are big time games that have sold lots of people playing them. They've sold lots of copies. Her current project is the Psychonauts 2 game. Cheryl Shavers, she's a chemist, she's an engineer, she's a businesswoman. Her field of study has been semiconductor engineering and management. She's the first African-American Undersecretary of Commerce for Science and Technology. And note that I did not say she's the first African-American woman. She's the first African-American Undersecretary of Commerce for Science and Technology. It is important to note that Cheryl Shavers is not was not born in 1865. Cheryl Shavers is alive and well right now, and she is still being listed as a first. Starlin Hernandez. This is a young woman who is based in Baltimore, and she is a spacecraft engineer. All of these links, all of these women have links for them so that you can go and read more about them. But I wanted to start with this because I wanted you all to see that when we think about what a scientist is or an engineer is, we need to start thinking about these women. These women are present, they are active, they are contributing to the field, and they are not somebody that we can just kind of glance over. These are heavyweights in STEM. So as we think about women in STEM, we are often told that the representation for women, and especially for women of color, is very low. And we kind of get this impression that it's only recently that women and women of color have wanted to even participate in STEM. And that's not really true. Women have been present at every major event in STEM, in science and engineering. So who are some of these women that were present in the very beginning? And what happened to them? Why don't we know who they are? So as a biologist, one of the best things to happen in biology was for us to figure out the 3D structure of DNA. We know that it is a double helix, and we give credit to whom for that? In your textbooks, it states very boldly and proudly, Watson and Crick were the ones who actually figured that out. It's not really true. Rosalind Franklin was a European scientist who had been working on this for a while. She had a colleague that she was working with, and they actually had a theory and an idea that's much more close to what we accept now as the double helix, the structure of the double helix, than Watson and Crick did. Her colleague had a conversation with Watson and Crick without her permission. They incorporated what she had figured out, what she thought, into their model, and boom, Watson and Crick were given credit for figuring out the double helix structure. In the beginning, her name wasn't mentioned at all. As time has gone along, she has become a footnote in science history. But it was actually her thoughts and her ideas that contributed to this double helix structure that we know and understand now. Lise Meitner. This was a young woman, a young Jewish woman, who was doing her work during World War II. She did her work during the height of the Nazi invasion. And as a result of the Nazi invasion, she actually had to stop and relocate to a different country for her safety. She's actually credited with understanding nuclear fission. Who cares? That's what the atomic bomb is based on. When we talk about the atomic bomb and we talk about Mr. Manhattan, and we talk about all those men who were secreted away working on this atomic bomb, they were working using information that had been gathered from Lise Meitner. And that's important to understand. Nuclear fission was figured out by a woman. Last but not least, we have Hedy Lamarr. A lot of our more seasoned people may know her as a movie star. She was a movie star, but she's also a scientist. And she played a major role in radio guidance. This is an example of where her ideas weren't just not credited, or she was not credited, was not just not credited for her ideas, but in this case, her ideas were actually stolen. So Hedy, along with a colleague, presented her ideas about radio guidance systems to the United States government military. They pretended to not be interested. It's the fact they really were interested. They were so interested, in fact, that they stole the idea. They then patented it and had patent listed as classified, so no one could work on it, not even her. And by the 1960s, they had begun to incorporate this technology into a host of weapon systems. The information that she created, the understanding that she had of radio guidance systems, we still use today. Wi-Fi, CDMA, Bluetooth, all of these things are based on that radio guidance system that came from Hedy. So it's important for us to think about the fact, to remind ourselves that women have been present in STEM always. They've been there for every turning point, and they always will be. We also have to deal with some serious facts. For example, women make up less than 25% of the STEM workforce. African-American women make up less than 2%. That's really, it's a problem on an end of, as it is, but it's a bigger problem when you think about the fact that women are 47% of the U.S. workforce. We are almost half of the U.S. workforce. Women hold 24% of STEM jobs. But for Black women, these numbers are even smaller. We make up 2.4% and 2% of science and engineering jobs, even though we make up about 6.4% of the total population. Now, this idea about women not being present and accounted for in STEM is not new. It's not a new issue. It's not something that we're just starting to deal with. There have been lots of initiatives that have been put in place at the local level and at university levels to work towards increasing the number of women in STEM. If you click on the link, it'll take you to a page that kind of that works through and explains some of these projects. At the federal level, we have granting agencies that have programs designed just to increase the number of women in STEM, to increase the number of minorities in STEM. For NSF, for example, we have advanced program, includes AGAP, HBCU UP. Excuse me. At the beginning of this talk, during the introduction, Dr. Wendt mentioned that this program is funded by the HBCU UP program. NIH has a host of programs that are designed to increase women participation as well as minorities. They have the SCORE program, they have the NRSA program. The DOD has the HBCU MI program. All these programs are designed to increase women, to increase diversity, to increase inclusion, and to increase equity. So we have these programs in place. Great, wonderful. We have money being funneled towards this. Great, wonderful. We could spend the entire time together today talking about whether these programs are working, whether these programs are not working, how we can make them better, how I think about them, how you think about them. But that's not what we're going to do. We're not going to spend our time rehashing these facts because we already know these. For many of us, we are living this. We're living this. I don't need to tell you about your lived experiences. You have them. We don't need to discuss, the dire state of women and women of color in STEM. One, because I'm tired. I'm tired of talking about it. I think we've done so many presentations on this. We have so many conversations about this. The numbers are low. We need to work on that. We can let that rest for this presentation. What I do want to do with you today, though, is I want to show you the women who are here. I want to show you examples of women who are in STEM and who are persisting. I want to talk about how this persistence is happening. I want to talk about the importance of these women in not only my STEM journey, but how women in STEM can be important in your STEM journey. So when I was putting this presentation together, I was really trying to figure out what I wanted to say. I was trying to figure out, as I went through my experiences as a graduate student, for college, at my postdocs, when I got to UDC, I was thinking about all the programs that were in place. I was thinking about all the opportunities that I had. But for every opportunity I had, there was a woman who was there with me. For every experience I had, there was a woman or women who were there with me, supporting me, encouraging me. And so I realized that for today, I don't want to talk to you about those opportunities and those other experiences. I want to focus on those women. And so I found this quote online that said, "I've come to the conclusion that if there is one thing that women must do to encourage more women to pursue careers in STEM fields, it's this: mentor them." In other words, the key to persistence is support. You need mentors and advisors, but I want you to think more broadly when I talk about mentoring and support. I want you to think about your tribe. I want you to think about your network, your village, your sister circle, your prayer circle, whatever you call the group of people that keep you encouraged, that are there to remind you of how great you are and to remind you of how wonderful the work is you're doing, even when you don't see it. I want you to think about the people who are singing your praises when you're not even in the room. When they're off somewhere and somebody mentions something and the first thing that pops to mind is you. They want to make sure that someone knows who you are. I want you to also think about the fact the women who hold you accountable. These are the ones who tell you when you slack it off, when you are not doing what you need to be doing, should be doing, or could be doing. These are the ones that are holding you up to that higher standard so that they can push you along. So today what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you my perspective, if I can stop coughing, I'm going to give you my perspective on persistence and focus. I am going to walk you through my journey in STEM by talking about the women who have been there with me to support me. Now, usually any one of these types of talks starts off with your family and how your family was there, but I'm not going to do that today because I want to focus on the women in STEM who have been a part of my life and who are part of my life. At the very beginning, there is Ashley Huderson, other Dr. Huderson. This is my sister. She has been and is the core, the bedrock, the anchor of my support system. She is always there encouraging me, sometimes even gaslighting me, I guess, just blowing up my head, making sure that I understand that I have something to contribute and I should contribute it. She is an accountability partner. She is a partner in work. We do a lot of work together. She's also a bully and she bullies me to get things done. And this, because she is my biological sister, it's not really shocking, right, that we have this type of relationship where she's there supporting me, but I'm the big sister. And so usually it's my responsibility to, or people expect that of me, to protect my sister and to teach her and lead her. And I do. And if anybody says anything bad about my sister, people have a problem. But the same thing happens, she does the same thing for me. She is my champion. Dr. Wendt sent out an email blast to UDC yesterday advertising this presentation. I said, great, I'm gonna get it together, great. A few seconds later, I got notifications that this talk had been posted on LinkedIn and Facebook. I had friends texting me, oh, I can't wait to see it. Oh, congratulations, blah, blah, blah. I didn't know how they found it. My sister posted it. She made sure that this was advertised because she felt like this was something important and that needed to be supported. That's what she does for me at all times, and that's what I do for her. In 1992, I met three women who changed my life, who are a part of my life to this very day, and will always be a part of my life. We've decided that at this point, it makes no sense for us to break up. That would be Kenitra Brooks, Ashley Jackson, and Christy Brumfield. I met them in 1992, my first day of high school. High school was very different for me. Prior to that, elementary school, middle school, I had been in all Black environments. I had also been a part of the smart kids. For high school, I stepped into a space that where I was no longer a part of the majority culture. It wasn't all Black. In fact, I was not only was I not a part of the majority, I was now literally the minority. In my high school, we Black people, Black students represented, I think at the time, maybe 15 to 20% of the student population. And we were a small school. I had a graduating class of about 140. We formed a bond. We worked together. We were friends. We supported each other. When things got crazy, the three of us would step to the back and be like, well, that's them. Let us be away from this. We encouraged each other's ideas. We encouraged each other's foolishness, but we loved each other. We supported each other and we took care of each other. And those are the parts of our relationship that have maintained throughout the years. And Kenitra and I moved over to Xavier University of Louisiana. At this point, we now became known as the Holy Trinity. And I don't mean whole as incomplete either. We were young and silly, and when you saw one, you saw the other. So the three of us entered into Xavier. All of us were biology, our biology pre-med majors. At some point, Kenitra had an epiphany, and she was like, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do my biology. I don't want to do medicine, and I don't want to be a physician. So she changed her major to English, and she then proceeded to just launch all the way off to this great career. We'll talk about her a little bit later. Ashley and I completed our bachelor's degrees in biology. Kenitra earned her earned a bachelor's of arts in English. While we were in college, we supported each other again. We were there, we were having a good time. We were very young, we didn't know what was going on. We were just happy to be there. We held each other accountable, like, did you do this work today? Sometimes the answer was no, and there was a chuckle. Sometimes the answer was no, let's get it done. We were there for each other, we supported each other. We made sure that at every step, it was always the three of us moving forward. No person was left behind. After we completed our undergraduate degrees, Ashley and I went over to the University of New Orleans. We began our master's work. When I tell you, we stepped into a brand new world. We had no clue what was going on. I didn't really understand what a master's degree was. I didn't understand what research was. I paid enough attention in college to get me through so that my parents wouldn't be upset with me. And so here I was now being expected to recall all that information from college that I didn't pay attention to. And I was again placed in this completely different environment. I went to an HBCU. It was all Black. It was Black excellence. It was all these things. And I was once again a part of the majority. Here we are at the University of New Orleans, and that doesn't happen anymore. I stepped into a program where Ashley and I at the time were the only students of color present. We really didn't know what was going on. We didn't understand what was going on. We just knew that we were there and we needed to be great. Our families were supporting us. They were so excited for us, but they didn't know what we were doing either. And so we really had to rely on each other to kind of get through. When I think about the things, the experiences that I had in my master's program, and none of them were terrible, but just the confusion and sometimes the isolation that I felt, I wonder if I would have made it through had my best friend not been at my side. There were so many times when I looked over to her and I said, "Do you know what's going on?" And her response to me was very confidently, "Girl, I don't know what they're talking about." But we were there together. And it made a difference because it made me feel like I wasn't the only one. It made me feel like I wasn't the only one who was confused or who was lost and who didn't get it. We finished our master's degrees in 2003. Ashley decided that her next step was going to be medical school. I still was not completely sure what I wanted to do, so I took a job at UNO as the freshman biology lab coordinator. I was in charge of all of the biology labs. I was responsible for teaching, setting them up, ordering. It was a lot of fun. I learned a whole lot. I had a lot of freedom, and it was great. For a newly minted master's candidate with all this freedom, I was getting a real paycheck. I was happy. But as I spent time in that program, I began to look around. I began to realize that, one, nobody there looked like me. I began to realize that there were so many things that I wanted to do. But the things that I wanted to do and the people who were doing them, they all had PhDs. And so I said, okay, I too shall get a PhD. I was also ready to leave home at 26. So I was ready to leave home. So I stepped into my next field. Now let me take a step back and go back to Christy. After high school, Christy attended Tulane University and she got her bachelor's of science in psychology, exercise, and sports science. Christy was not like me and Ashley. She was a little bit more focused. She knew what she wanted to do. And so there were times when I would look to her like, "So what are you doing? Because I think that might be what I need to do." She went on to get her master's in health, master's of health science and rehabilitation counseling. Again, what are you doing? Because I might need to think about that too. She was there, she was focused. She could provide me with some context so that I could think back and say, okay, well, what do I want to do? And how do I get to what I want to do? So at this point, it's time for me to go off to my PhD. I decided I didn't want to be at home anymore. I had lived at home all the way through my master's and working at UNO. It was time to leave. It was time to spread my wings. And true to form, I decided to jump into a completely different field, a completely different state, a completely different time zone. And I landed at Virginia Tech, specifically in the College of Arts, College of Agriculture and Life Sciences, in the dairy science program. Now, I'm from New Orleans. I'm a little old Black girl. I have a bachelor's in biology and I have a master's in biological science. None of this is agriculture, but I thought it's fine, I can do it. So I show up to Virginia Tech and it's a whole new world. It's not just about other women present, other Black people present. It's literally a completely different world. The language is different, the people are different, the topic is different. And it was overwhelming. The first people I met in my program were Christy Daniels, which you can see here laughing at me, Bissy Villiuden, we call her Bissy B, and these are my lab mates. We worked together in lab, we supported each other. The first day I walked into lab, Christy looked, I don't know whether it was pity or whether it's just who she was, but she was like, "Come on, Let me show you what you need to do. Let's go out to the farm. Let me show you what's happening at the farm. She was the one that helped me figure out what I should wear to the farm. She's like, first off, you need to get some rubber boots because the tennis shoes not going to work. And you probably should invest in bibs. And bibs are the jumpsuits that we wore on the farm. She was like, because you could be covered in poop. So get your farm clothes together. Make sure you pull your hair back. These were things that I needed to know. It was a little bit of an intimidating place to be because I was surrounded by individuals, fellow graduate students who had been in agriculture all of their lives. Some of them had grown up on farms. And here I am at 25, stepping into this space, like, yes, I'm here and I'm going to be great. Busy was a little petite woman who was a veterinarian back in her home country of India. She was here working on her PhD, and she was brilliant. She was so smart. I learned so much from her in terms of the science, the agriculture science, animal science. And in return, what I gave to her was kind of a working knowledge of the world around us. There would be conversations that we would have. We would talk about science and I'm taking all this in. But then there'd be other conversations that we'd be having where I'm telling her about my life experiences. I'm telling her about what's going on in the world. These are my lab partners. These are the women that I spent my time with. And this picture in the center right here, these two pictures really sums up a lot of my research experience with my lab sisters, or what I refer to as my co-BFFs. That's who we are. We are co-BFFs. We worked together. We got things done. We supported each other. We made sure that, again, there was no person left behind. The other addition to this group will be right here, Stephanie Hill. Stephanie Hill was a graduate student in the program. And the first time I met her, I was climbing into the back of her car going to lunch. Christy had come over to my desk and said, hey, we're going to lunch. Let's go. Stephanie shows up in her red 4x4, and I introduce myself. I have good manners. I say, hi, I'm Brandy, the new graduate student. She immediately looks at me, looks me up and down, yells out of the truck, woohoo, another fat girl. Come on, boo. Hop in the car. And that was the beginning of a beautiful relationship. Stephanie was always there. She was always there with comic relief and chocolate. If there was anything you needed, if there was ever a moment when you were sad or unhappy, all you needed was SR Hill, and she was there for you. Our relationship evolved. She became very pivotal, in my progression at Virginia Tech. We decided to coin ourselves as Ebony and Ivory, which is probably ridiculously inappropriate, but that's who we were. We had some similar life experiences that we could share. She was never going to ever let you sit and be unhappy. She was there pushing you to get your work done because homegirl was ready to party. We were ready to go and get on to the next thing. And so I need you to do your work so that we can go ahead and move to our next vacation. I was blessed while at Virginia Tech to really have two families. So here's my research family that supported me in my research, that supported me in my agricultural journey, that made sure that I was always with them and understood what was going on. But I also had another family while I was there, my VT prep family. So while I was at Virginia, when I got to Virginia Tech, I entered through the VT prep program. It's a post-bac program that is designed for people to get people into graduate school. And it's for people who may not have had the grades in undergrad or may not have done so well in GRE or who were changing their research focus. And the last one was me. So some of the women that I met, Rolanda Finlay, Davida Camara, Alicia Fegan, and Carrie Sutton. Now, these women were different from my research family because we weren't in the same field. Rolanda was a psychologist, Davida was working on poultry genetics, Alicia was a virologist, and Carrie was working on science and technology with society. So we're in very different fields. But we formed a bond to support each other as we moved through our program. For some of us, we were the only ones in our program, the only Black woman, may have been the only woman in some cases in our program. And so we were there to provide that type of support for each other. There were moments when we were absolutely at our worst. And it was these women who were there to pull us up. We pulled each other up, we pulled each other along. We made sure that we were all okay. If that required us to meet once a week for dinner, that's what we did. There was one summer when we were all just struggling. So every day for dinner, we met at somebody's house. Somebody was responsible for cooking dinner. That's what we did. And it didn't last for forever, but it was just enough to make sure that we were all okay and that nobody was leaving, nobody was giving up, that we were all going to make it together. We all completed our degrees, we've all moved on, but we still belong to that same circle of love and support. These are some pictures of some of the other women who were crucial to my, me remaining in my PhD program. They were there to lend me strength when I needed it, and they allowed me to lend them strength when they needed it. So at the top, we have Lachelle Waller. There are so many things that I did at Virginia Tech because of her. I don't even remember when we met. I feel like there was never a time when we were not friends. I know I didn't meet her when I was 5 or 10 because I didn't meet her to Virginia Tech, but I can't remember when we met because it didn't matter. We were instantly friends, and I would get emails or people would stop me and say, hey, Lachelle said that I need to talk to you because you need to be on my panel. Or I'd get a text message from Lachelle, hey, there's this going on. I want you to be a part of this. I don't even know what that is. She's like, it's fine. We're going to figure it out. She was determined to make sure that I was great, and I was determined to make sure that she was great. The woman standing with her is Wojina Jackson Glover. She was there in engineering. Towards the end of our PhD, our dissertation research, we became rocks for each other. We worked on our dissertations together. We blew off steam together. We were there to hold each other's hands as we just prayed that we were going to get through the dissertation. But again, the point was to make sure that nobody was left behind. It was to make sure that we were all achieving and succeeding. And on those days and those moments when we needed support to not give up, when we needed the encouragement, we were there for each other. Leah Banks is another woman who was always up for a good time. She was determined to not let the stress of the graduate school deter us. And that's what she did. In this picture, we were at her house decorating gingerbread houses. We should have been at home studying, probably, but that's not what we needed at that moment. We needed to be together so that we could provide that energy to each other. Tamisha Vaughn, she, again, was there. She traveled all through graduate school, but if I called her for anything, she was there. I needed to put together a bed. Homegirl showed up with a toolbox. She wanted to make jambalaya. She called me on the phone. I walked her through that process. That is how we supported each other. Along the way, I got to meet some very awesome women. Jamaica Bird, even in graduate school, she was a first. She was the first woman to receive her PhD in computer science from her program. If you Google her now, she's done great things. She's established many programs that are working with girls in engineering and computing. And to this day, if I accidentally run in the store, it's a conversation that continues. Tell me what you need. Tell me what you want to do. You need something. Okay, I have a grant going on right now. Do I need to pull you in on this grant to make sure that you have what you need for tenure? Let me know. Serena Parks, she's now Serena Williams. She's always standing behind me, whispering in my ear, do you think that's the right thing for you to do? Is this gonna help you achieve your goals? She's support, she's love, she's all that wrapped up into one. And then there's Siobhan Thorpe, who fed us through graduate school. She was determined to make sure that we were gonna be happy, full, and fed. So once I graduated, I went on to complete 2 postdocs, like Dr. Wynn said. So my first postdoc was at the Tulane School of Medicine, and then my second postdoc was in DC at Georgetown. When I stepped into Tulane, again, it was a change of environment. It was very different, but I stepped into the capable hands of some very phenomenal women. Tamika Duplessis, Trivia Fraser were 2 of my lab mates. They were excited about their research. They were excited about me. We formed a bond that supported each other. We had a very driven mentor. He wanted data, data, data. And there were times when we were all considering just walking out of the lab, like, oh, it's too much. But we were there for each other. We reminded each other what we were there for. We figured out how to support each other. We figured out how to make things happen so that we could continue to be successful. To this day, whenever I go home, I do my best to meet up with these women so that we can talk about how great we are, so we can talk about how we've supported each other, so we can talk about our plans for the future so that we can continue to support each other. While at this postdoc, I had the opportunity to be co-author on a review paper. This came about because of Florestina Payton. I was sitting outside stressing over a manuscript, a review paper that my colleague had asked me to proofread and edit for him. It needed a lot of work. I had been working on this for a while. She walked up to me and she was like, what are you doing? I was like, I'm working on this review paper. It's taking up so much and I'm just trying to figure out what to do. She said, put your pen down, baby. She was like, are you an author on this paper? And I was like, I don't know. She was like, you need to get up immediately and go find out, are you an author? If you're not an author, you turn in what you've done, you wish them well, and you keep moving. If you are an author, then you continue your edits. I needed that because I had no idea. It didn't even cross my mind to ask about author credit. I was just doing a colleague a favor. Because of that interaction that I had with her, because she reminded me, because she put it on my mind, because she supported me and wanted to make sure that I was successful, I got to be second author on this review paper. I needed that at that moment. And then there have been times in return when I have been there to support her, to push her, to remind her of all that she's accomplished when she was scared, when it was time to apply for tenure. Girl, you have this. All of these are things that your circle should be doing to you. These are the things that have helped me to maintain and persist and move along. Vanetta Horn, she was not a part of our lab, but she was good friends with all of these women. And when I joined the lab, she was like, okay, good, let's go. I'm putting you on panels. I want to make sure that people know who you are. I want to walk you around the building so you'll know what to do and who to do it with. That is the kind of support that helped me to remain focused and that helped me to be successful, not only in this postdoc, but thinking back to graduate school, to college. All of these women have been there to support me. All of these women who are working in STEM have been there to support me. When I got to Georgetown, I met two more phenomenal women, Kedra Cyrus, Vashti Bryant. Kedra was already a postdoc in the lab that I was in. She showed me the ropes. She was like, let me tell you something right now. This is what you need to do so that we can keep moving. When things weren't working right, when we were just like, this don't make no sense. We were there together. We had lunch together. We commiserated together. We were uncertain about our future together. Vashti was there with us. She was a postdoc that came in at the same time that I did. She was very quiet and she's very calm. And so while Kendra and I were just blowing our heads off and just upset, Vashti was there. She's like, y'all wanna take a walk? She provided that counterbalance for us. She helped us to put things into perspective. And she's still doing that to this very day for me. Once I completed my two postdocs, I joined faculty here at UDC. I was so excited. I was so nervous. I was so anxious. I was excited to get started. I was excited to be contributing. Sometimes people are trying to provide you with useful tidbits of information, but really what they're doing is they're putting doubts inside of you. And so when I told people I was coming to UDC, they were like, you know, it's going to be really hard. You are an assistant professor. You need to establish yourself. It's hard to start off working at a small HBCU. Do they have money? Do they have resources? What's happening? And so I got a little worried. But then I landed here. And some of the first people that I met at UDC were some of my colleagues in biology. For example, Dr. Kuzan. Dr. Kuzan has been funded at this small HBCU that focuses on teaching. At the time for over 20 years. She had publications. She was a well-known electron microscopist. I know one other electron microscopist and she is in law school. So she could succeed, so it's not impossible. Dr. Dixon was running the STEM Center. It was a federally funded STEM Center. NSF gives her money to run the STEM Center. The grant has been renewed. This was in addition to the research that she done. So these women have been successful. I met Dr. Rosie Sneed, found out Dr. Sneed she's a veterinarian, and she has a PhD. She's here, she's teaching, she's successful, she has a research program. At the same time that I came in, Dr. Maddie Knight came in full-time as well. Dr. Knight had her own lab at a separate facility. She was internationally known, and she chose to come to UDC for her impact. The first professional development series that I went to, which is what the faculty do in the 2 weeks prior to the start of the semester. Dr. Laura Thompson was standing up being applauded for the work that she's done and the grants that she received. Dr. Laura Thompson has created an entire program, biomedical engineering, and she has her own lab, which is the Center for Biomedical and Rehabilitation Engineering here at UDC. So, if all of these women are in STEM and they're thriving, clearly I can do the same, right? So the women that I met just at UDC were support system. I could go to them, to talk to them, to ask them questions, to find out information, to figure out how to chart my path. Dr. Wendt will have to forgive me for this picture that I just snatched off the internet, but I was present for Dr. Wendt's as part of our interview committee. And listening to her talk and thinking about the fact that she wanted to come to UDC, once she got here, being a part of projects with her, grant projects, she and I presented together. There's a paper that we just published together. These are, Dr. Wendt is also a part of that champion group. When she invited me to do this talk, she was like, so here's the date, here's the time, I trust you, have a great time. She never questions. She's like, nope, Brandy will get it done, it's fine. This is the type of support that you need to be thinking about. This is the type of support that leads to persistence for women in STEM. So while at UDC, I was exposed to so many different things. I was exposed to different grants with Dr. Wendt. I was exposed to different programs that were occurring on campus, and it made me really think that there's so much that I could do with my PhD. And I wanted to take some time to explore that. So my sister, a couple of years before, had completed a fellowship with AAAS. She loved it. She spoke very highly of it. And so I thought, okay, I'll apply. I'll see. The minute I let those words leave my mouth, phone calls, email, text messages, sis, I heard you want to apply for this fellowship. Send me your application. Here's my application. Send me your statements. Let me read over your statements. Let's work on this to make sure your application is tight so we can get you in the door. Once I made it past the first round we had to submit a writing sample. Here's a copy of my writing sample, sis. Let me see your writing sample. Let me tell you what you need to concentrate on. Got it? Good. Great. When it's time for me to have my interview, again, emails, calls, I went over, people came to my house. People showed up with a bottle of wine and time. We sat down and we looked at the opportunities that were being presented for this fellowship. They were going in and telling me, you don't want to work here. You don't want to work here. This is where you want to work. If you're going to work here, you want to work with these people. These women were vested in making sure that I had a successful experience in this fellowship. And let me take a step back. The purpose of this fellowship is to take individuals who have PhDs in science or at least a master's in engineering, and they place you in a federal agency. So you are taking your science expertise and they're placing you in an environment where you can learn about science policy and contribute to science policy. So once I got into the fellowship, I got my placement at the National Science Foundation. Again, women are there. So who are you working with? What are you going to be doing? What are you interested in doing? Let's make sure we get you set up with the right people. Most of these women that I met at the fellowship were younger than me, but they're still providing me with information, mentoring, just support that I needed to be successful. In return, I could explain to them some of my process for academia. I could talk to them about the scientific process. There were so many ways that we could exchange information and exchange support for each other to make sure that we were successful. Some of these women, some of you all have actually seen, they presented on campus or will be presenting on campus. So Dominique Carter has been one of my biggest supporters. I call her on the phone just to say hi, and I got to give her a rundown of what I've done for the day. While I was at the fellowship, a lady walked up to me, sat down next to me really easily, just looked me in the eyes and was like, so I'm your mentor. Excuse me? Simone Soso was like, I'm your mentor, and we're going to make sure that you get what you need. Felicia Full of Love was in the same position that I was in. Her cubicle was right next to mine. And everywhere she went, come on, let's go. You're coming with me. Call this person. Talk to this person. Vashti has been a part of my support system since my postdoc. Quincy Brown is a policy genius. If you have questions about this, she answers them with no problem. Maria Carranza is a fellow who came in with me. She and I shared experiences because she too was coming from academia into this fellowship. And so there were conversations that she and I have, that we have. How do we do a tenure? We can provide a different perspective to people because we are academics. We have been in academic positions. This is my support system. They are here to make sure that the words I'm leaving, I'm quitting, never come out of my mouth. They are there so that they can be a blessing and a support to me, and that I can be the same for them. All of the women that I have shown you all have PhDs, are MDs. All of them are active in STEM. When you're sitting around and you're thinking about the lack of representation, the lack of women being present, stop and think about who is surrounding you. Yes, we know that that exists out in the world, but sometimes we have to take, we have to look a little bit closer. You have to see what's actually sitting right in front of you, so that you can use that as the support that you need, so that you can use that as the buffer that you need as you are maneuvering through these spaces that may not be very kind to you, I mean, well, or even welcoming to your presence. But don't get so bogged down in the numbers that you forget about these women who surround you every day. Some of them are going to be your friends that are going to eventually turn into colleagues. Some of them are going to be your professors. Some of them are going to just be people you meet on the street. But incorporate them into your network. Bring them into the space so that you can be a part of their network and they can be a part of yours. So some of the women that I contacted about being in my presentation wanted to make sure that I also showed you all professional pictures of them to remind you all that, yes, we had a great time in graduate schools, but they are really adults. I have listed the names of every single woman in this presentation, because I want you all to look them up. I want you all to look at them and see their stories and see who they are and figure out if they fit into your circle or if you can fit into their circle. So, I've broken it. There we go. While I talk about the women in STEM who were supporters, there are also women who are not in STEM who have also been instrumental in my success and my persistence. I spoke to you earlier about Kenitra Brooks. She's not in STEM. What she is she's in Black Horror. She's pretty famous right now. She writes books about Beyonce all the time. You should definitely look her up. I have my line sisters here. These women think that I can do anything. I could call them right now and be like, I broke something. Girl, you didn't break it, you just made it better. That's the kind of support that you need sometimes. They also hold me accountable. They have no problems telling me when I did not do what I was supposed to do. They say it with love, but they're very stern about it. These other women that are here, they have been there supporting. We may not talk every day. We may not even talk every year. But the minute that text message goes through, that email goes through, they're there. They are there to support. They call me so that I can figure out how to support them. They have no problem saying, listen, I don't know what I'm doing. I need your help. And that's when I get to step in and repay what they've done for me. One of the women who I was introduced to almost immediately when I got to UDC, who was not a part of my biology program, was Dr. Anika Burton. She was my faculty buddy. She has been kind of like a UDC mother to me almost. Come on, baby, let's figure out what we got to do to get you together. Let's figure out what you need to do. I have no problems doing the same thing for her. Dr. Burton preferred to not spend her time elbow deep in STEM, although she is always elbow deep in STEM. But I have no problems coming in and providing her with that expertise, with those clarification points, because I want her to be just as great as she wants me to be. So as we move along, I want to remind you all that women have always been a part of STEM. They have persisted using many mechanisms, but the one that I find to be the most helpful has been the one of creating support for each other. For those, here are some resources that you can look through that talk about some of these women in STEM who are our unspoken heroes, who have contributed to these huge projects, these huge turns in science, and don't get the proper credit. Know these women, learn these women, so that when you have your opportunities, you can use their names, you can tell who they are, you can think about what they've done, and you can realize that they have already created a path for us. So, there was a slide I wanted to put in there. The karma is working for me. It was a slide that was going to have a terrible picture of my sister as a baby, but it's fine. I want to encourage you all to ask any questions you have. I'm going to find that slide because it's going to be up. I will send this presentation to Dr. Wendt so that you all will have the names of all the women so that you can contact them. I encourage you all to make use of the women that are in your immediate circle, as well as branching out, using social media, using your research skills to find others who are in the space that you want to be in, or that can help you get to the space that you want to be in. My contact, so this is my UDC email. It's also my LinkedIn and my Twitter account. I will not tell you a lie. I don't be on Twitter that often, and I will do my best to respond to you on LinkedIn. Dr. Wendt also put my NSF email address in there. If there are questions, if there's anything that you need, please feel free to email me. I am available to you. Sometimes it takes me a while to answer the emails, but I will get to you. And yeah, I think that's it.
What a great presentation. Thank you so much, Dr. Huderson. I am so touched about everything that you have shared, but especially to hear more about your bond with your sister, Ashley, which you had shared with me before. But I think it's great that you were able to share that with everyone else. Your Holy Trinity, your co-BFFs, and the VT prep program, and how each of the women in your life have lifted you up, and in turn, you've lifted them to be successful. So as you mentioned, now we're going to open the floor for questions and answers. If you have a question, go ahead and type it into the chat box so that I can facilitate the question and answer session with Dr. Huderson.
Let me do one thing. I found there was one slide that I didn't get a chance to present, and I think it's important. I pushed the wrong button. I'm so sorry.
There's nothing to apologize for.
I am technologically competent. So this is that slide I was looking for. So let me just say that the key to persistence is support. This is where I get to plug my family. So you should always find women who are there to support and uplift you and hold your hand as you move through, who are there to embrace you with the hugs that you may not want at the time. And I had to put my father in here because that's my daddy. So there you go. This slide is not going to be in the PDF because I don't think my daddy wants his face out there like that. So, all right, now I'm done.
Thank you so much for sharing that. I've never seen a picture of your dad before. That's awesome. So a few questions have been going on in the chat box. One question, Leticia Terrell had asked about where medical doctors fall within STEM. And I had shared about STEM, S-T-E-M-M. Could you elaborate on the NSFs and the AAAS's definition of STEM and the categorization of STEM fields?
So we are in a point right now where everything is evolving. We want to make sure that we're not leaving anybody out. And also we're also trying to make sure that people have a full understanding of what science and engineering and math and medicine are. These are not really all these separate fields, right? These are things that work together to help us explain phenomena. Whether we're explaining phenomenon in the natural world or phenomenon in the body, it's still explaining phenomena that are occurring. So NSF and AAAS kind of have this very expanded definition and understanding of STEM. If you go to the NSF page, they include economics in their STEM. The study of economics the science of economics is considered to be a part of STEM. For AAAS, they consider social sciences to be a part of STEM. In terms of medicine, we tend to look at medicine as being this completely separate field, and it's not. It's based on science. They rely on science to get all of the work done and to get all their work done. It's also important to understand that lots of medical doctors are involved in research. Whether it's clinical research or basic research, they're still doing research. So there is a place for everybody across the STEM spectrum. Don't get hung up on titles. Think about what's actually being done in the spaces. Look at the explanations behind these things. Don't just get caught up because it says science or engineering or math that doesn't apply to you. Lots of things apply to science. Science is just the study of a process. So anything that has a process can fall into science.
Thank you very much. Another question is, what are some research programs in biology available at UDC?
So research programs meaning what? So who's doing what type of research?
I believe so. So I guess what is available at UDC in the realm of biology and any sort of research science?
Okay, so first thing I would do is suggest that you go down to the STEM Center. Ms. Wood knows every faculty member and knows what every faculty member is doing. But in addition to that, there is there's cancer research that's going on. There is invertebrate research that's going on. So Dr. Sneed is working with invertebrates. She's also working with the endocannabinoid system. And I think she's here, which is the it's the marijuana pathway. There's chemistry research is going on, and I cannot tell you off the top of my head coherently what the research is. This is what I would suggest you do. I would suggest you to look at the people who are in the program. All of us are doing research. You can Google our names and find out what the research that we're working on as well. There's also research going on in engineering. There's research that's going on in education. And so I think the best thing for you to do, honestly, is to look at the people's names, to Google them, and they give you a breakdown of what the research is. I do know that we are in the process of revamping the webpage so that you will be able to access that information a lot quicker. But I think that's probably the best way to get an accurate view of the research that's going on at UDC. You can also look at our sponsor programs office. They keep a running tally of the research that's being conducted at UDC too.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Huderson. I've added the web link to the STEM Center on the main UDC page to the chat box. And I will also add the link to the Office of Sponsored Programs. Another question, I would like to know your outlook on HBCU medical schools versus non-HBCU medical schools. Do you have a preference? Should we apply to both?
Of course I have a preference. Girl, you need to go to HBCU. I'm sorry, not girl, but whoever asked that question. I think you need to think about what the mission of the schools are. I think you need to think about the environment that exists at each school. I absolutely think that you should apply to HBCU medical schools. Howard is an HBCU. Howard has a medical school, has a pharmacy school, has a dental school, top notch. So don't use the fact that it's an HBCU to think that it's going to provide you with any less of anything. It's going to provide you with a little bit more, if you ask me. I think, now with that said, everybody does not do well at an HBCU, just like everybody does not do well at a PWI. I think you need to look at the environment that's being created, and I think you need to think about the focus for the schools. If the focus is to just get you into the classroom, get you to pass your test and get you out, and you're comfortable with that, that's fine. Some people need a little bit more support. They need a little bit more wraparound structure. In that case, you may need to look for a school that's smaller, that's going to provide you with more one-on-one interaction with the professors, that's going to give you a smaller class dynamic. Don't get caught up on whether it's an HBCU or not. At this point, you need to be thinking about what that school is going to provide you in terms of how you're going to succeed once you finish.
That is great advice. There's some conversation also going around regarding Delta Sigma Theta. Can you tell us a little bit about your sorority?
Yes, Delta Sigma Theta sorority is the greatest sorority in the world. It is a service-based organization of college-educated women. We are focused on a daily basis on creating a better world. We are active in STEM. We are active in government. We are active in the humanities. We're active in the arts. There is the collegiate or undergraduate side, and there's also the graduate side. Both of these are working towards the same mission, creating better spaces, equitable spaces for all who are involved. We began as social activists. That's what we've done, and that's what we continue to do. We support women, we encourage women, we expect excellence from the women that belong to the organization, and we exemplify that by stating that we are an organization of college educated women. This is not an encouragement for everybody to pledge Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, although I think you couldn't go wrong if you did it, but it is a lifetime commitment. It is expected that you will participate and that she will represent our organization to the best at all times. And so if that is the route you want to take, congratulations, you made a great choice. But also, but like anything that you do, you should always think about the commitment that you are making.
Thank you, Dr. Huderson. So I have a question for you. Mm-hmm. And this is something that I think you and I have spoken about a bit, but may be helpful to our participants. How have you selected or accepted the phenomenal women in your life into the fold? So in other words, were you strategic or in any way, or were there any specific characteristics or circumstances that you most appreciated?
So the majority of the women that are part of my circle have been very organic. We have clicked by personality, really by personality. For those of you who may not know, I might be a lot. And so I find women who support that, who allow me to be myself. And that's for a lot of the women that I've met, that is the organic beginnings of our relationships. Now, there are some women who I have been very strategic about contacting and bugging and making sure that they are a part of my circle. One of those women that I can tell you about, her name is Kelly Mack. She is a former professor at UMES. I remember seeing her one day at a conference, and I read her biography, and I was like, oh, I want to be her. And so one of the things that I was able to do with this fellowship was to cold email her and be like, hey, I want to be you. Can you tell me how to be you? Let's meet and let's talk about it. So it's a mix of both. Do not feel as though everybody needs to be a part of your circle. Do not feel as though everybody that you come into contact with has to be a part of your support system, because that's not realistic. There are going to be people who you're going to meet and you all don't click, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's just personalities. Everybody ain't for everybody. But when you do find somebody, and it doesn't have to always be somebody who's older than you or somebody who's more advanced than you. It could be somebody that's sitting right next to you in your class. And you can simply say, you know what, we do good. We work well with each other. We get along well. So let's support each other. So it doesn't always have to be calculated, but there are going to be times when you're going to meet somebody or see somebody and you're like, yep, that person needs to be a part of my circle, and I got to figure out how to make it happen.
Excellent advice. Thank you for sharing that. So one of our participants asks, she says, I have a question. I plan on getting a master's degree in cybersecurity to work in the civil rights department in the FBI, CIA, or NSA. What advice would you give on keeping moving forward to doing your master's degree as well as doing a degree in a primarily white institution?
So the first thing I think you should do is always be working on your support system. I think you also need to make sure that you are paying attention so that when opportunities arise, you can take advantage of those opportunities. And let's be clear, there's not always a clear connection between an opportunity and how it's going to benefit you in the future. Sometimes you just need to do things at that very moment and worry about how they'll fit later. So I think that's the first thing. Going into a PWI does not automatically mean you're going to struggle. It does not automatically mean that it's going to be hard. Cyberspace is a male-dominated space, and so that will pose to be a challenge. But don't walk into a PWI thinking that I'm going to have to fight and claw, because that's not always the case. And you shouldn't walk into every HBCU or every space that's only women or every space that's only women of color and think that it's going to be smooth sailing because they all look like you. That's not always the case. But as you are working towards your master's, as you are working towards cybersecurity, one of the things that I would strongly encourage you to do is I would encourage you to turn to LinkedIn. I would encourage you to turn to LinkedIn to find people who are working in that space so that you can start communicating with them. And it doesn't have to be women. It doesn't have to be women of color. Men can be wonderful advisors and mentors. And just like you have to do with women, you just have to do your due diligence. But I think that's probably where I would start is looking for people who are in the space that you want to be in or think you want to be in and start conversations with them. A lot of times people are more than willing to be of assistance or service to you. And if they can't do it, they're willing to find people or to point you in the right direction to people who will be able to serve.
Thank you. And that is a perfect segue into the reminder that Dr. Huderson's contact information has been added to the chat box, both the UDC email address and the NSF email address, as well as my own contact information and the program or project website. So if any of you have questions, you think of things later or want to know more about Dr. Huderson's experience, what we have to offer at UDC, or about the NSF funded project, please do not hesitate to reach out to us. Mm-hmm. So I want to thank each of you again for joining us today. Dr. Huderson, your expertise and experiences are incredibly valuable, and I truly appreciate you taking the time to share them with us today, and to also share your charge for women to continue to step up and rise up to shape the future of STEM.